This week on Maker Update, pressing all the buttons, ramping up your phone distractions, flipping through the days, and a portrait by the numbers. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome back to another Maker Update. I'm coming to you this week from a new spot. This is the CREACIÊNCIA lab in Barcelona. I'm mixing things up, and I'm hoping you're also finding ways to keep things fresh. I've got a great show for you. Let's get started with the project of the week. On the Tested YouTube channel, we have a new project from Adam Savage, and I don't know whether he'd agree with me here, but I think this might be a first-of-its-kind type of project for Adam. It's a recreation of the Empire State Building elevator panel from the movie Elf, allowing you the taboo pleasure of pressing the buttons for every floor. And on the one hand, it's a movie prop replica, which is absolutely in the wheelhouse of Adam Savage projects. And Adam takes all the same rigor in unearthing and replicating the details of the original panel from the movie, its size and shape, the number and spacing of the buttons. He even found the Canadian elevator equipment manufacturer of the specific buttons used in the original panel and ordered a new batch for his project. But here's the thing. Because Adam used the same industrial spec, nearly indestructible materials and components found in an actual elevator panel, the end result isn't just another incredible replica to put in the trophy case. Instead, this is the kind of interactive design piece that you could put into a children's museum or a public space and invite anyone to play with. In this way, it's more like a Tim Hunkin mechanical arcade game designed for abuse and repairability. The fact that he mounted this piece in the entryway of his home for guests to play with shows that Adam must recognize this unique aspect of the project. I think it's awesome, and I personally hope that it sparks a Hunkin-like direction for more projects from Adam that can hold up the hands-on public interaction. More projects, from elevator size to pocket size, check out this 3D printed mechanical marble machine smartphone case on the KARAKURI channel. This project is a great mix of gears and movement, product design, and an approachable dash of clockwork engineering. It also just puts a smile on my face. The whole thing runs off a single motor with a worm gear. The tiny motor is powered by connecting the phone to a little voltage regulator board displayed within the case. There's even a little space carved out for storing the jumper cable. A couple little details to appreciate here. First, there's the spirit level included in the design so that you can make any adjustments for the whole thing to work correctly. I also like the use of 3D printed text and arrows pointing out different aspects of the design. And finally, there's this clever mode selector switch that releases the marbles, collects them, or locks them away. I think another reason this project appeals to me is that it's a completely analog distraction attached to the back of a completely digital one. There's a nice balance to it all. Speaking of analog, check out this flip calendar by Marta STL that uses a mixture of 3D printing and laser engraving. This is a reimagining of an antique calendar invented in the 1920s with a very classic look. How I understand it is that it's essentially a box with a window on each side to view the date. When you flip it over, the wooden tiles inside with the dates engraved on them, they slip past each other in sequence. So with each flip, you advance the number forward until it loops around to the first again. It's a neat idea, and even though it's an antique design, it's new to me, and this reinterpretation for 3D printing and laser cutting seems like a rewarding project. For something completely different that could only be done in the here and now, take a look at Analytic Portrait by Shinseungback Kimyonghun. By now, you've probably seen how AI computer vision algorithms can process images of people and accurately detect their facial features and identify arms and legs and hands. And from these data points, you can even make predictions of whether people are happy or angry, their gender, their race, their age. Well, what if you used all that data to make computer vision portraits? A portrait that depicts you the way the computer sees you. It's not the most flattering picture, especially when they include data on your beauty percentage, but there's also something wonderfully lo-fi and minimal about the whole thing. As an aesthetic, it's pretty cool in its own way. Now for some tips and tools. On Adafruit, John Park shares a guide on how to use Bottango software to animate servo-controlled animatronics. We've covered Bottango on the show before, but this is a great reminder of how unique and useful this free software is. It's also an opportunity to see the potential for it through the Adafruit lens. To me, it really is the missing ingredient for bringing character-based projects to life and stepping into the world of DIY Imagineering. I'll leave a link to John's guide and demos down in the description, along with a direct link to the Bottango software page. On the TenTech YouTube channel, there's a video explaining a 3D printing post-processing script they've developed called Bricklayers. The script is available on GitHub for both Prusa Slicer and Orca Slicer, and as I understand it, the process makes it so that the layer walls in your print alternate by half a layer, providing some added strength. It's an interesting idea that I expect will be eventually integrated into slicer settings, but until then, if your goal is to maximize the strength of your 3D printed part, this Python script add-on may give you the edge you need. And on Matt Perillo's YouTube channel, a highly relatable video for all of us who struggle to carve out physical space for making things. When you're living in a rented apartment, especially with a partner or your family, your options are limited when it comes to working on projects. But you also have to be realistic that a better space may not be coming along anytime soon. In his video, Matt demonstrates how he's been able to make a shared office desk and a nearby closet work as a super compact modular workspace. Not only does Matt offer a ton of practical advice, but it's also a refreshing perspective on a situation so many of us are navigating: shared living spaces that bear no resemblance to the dream workshops and garages we see on YouTube. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, a video from Zach the Bite-Size Engineer that I think perfectly complements the apartment workshop video from Matt. In Zach's video, he's reorganizing his collection of electronic components and those piles of failed or forgotten projects we all have. There's a good old-fashioned reorg here and basic tips for grouping things together and labeling your bins, but there's also a demonstration on how to use an online software called binner.io along with a wireless barcode scanner to quickly catalog your DigiKey orders and keep track of your own inventory. All right, and that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. Thanks to CREACIÊNCIA for the use of their lab. They're an amazing resource for childhood science education in Barcelona. Thanks as always to DigiKey for continuing to make this show possible, and thank you for watching. I'll see you soon.